So it's an absolute pleasure to have you with us today to talk about what will be a really, really fascinating and interesting month. Just tell us about the theme for this year's LGBT plus History Month.
Sure. We started doing themes back in 2011, and this year it's mind, body and spirit, which kind of fortuitously, I think, links beautifully with what we're dealing with COVID. And also with the fact that schools have now got to take on board the concept of relationship and sex education. So it's a very fortuitous and happy circumstance that we are doing mind, body and spirit in 21.
And these things sometimes just happen and fit in quite nicely. But what a crucial sort of conversation to have, particularly given the year we've just been through.
Indeed. Yes, absolutely.
And in terms of the success of LGBT History Month and the way that it's grown year on year, how have you seen that growth and what does it mean to you as the creator of it?
Well, I was a co-creator. Paul Patrick and I worked together for many years on Schools Out. We ran conferences throughout the whole time of Section 28. And we were really tired of being victims. So when Section 28 finished in 2003, we really felt it was time to get into schools and everywhere else and celebrate who we were as LGBT people. So we managed to get a small grant off the Department of Education. And I was living in Southwark at the time, and they had just appointed an LGBT officer. We'd done lots of work in Southwark. We had an anti-homophobic policy there and a forum. And we were training the police. So it was a borough that was really aware of the issues. And Dax got us the Tate Modern, and we had a launch in the cinema there, which was very exciting. The amusing thing is there are about 13 of us on stage, almost as many as in the audience, because it was done very quickly, but you know, it was a fair audience. But the reason there was 13 of us was because I was really keen to make clear the diversity of the LGBT population. So I had three trans people, I had LGBT people of every ethnicity and age, and I had a heterosexual ally. So from the very start, we were very keen, A, to make it grassroots so everybody could join in, and B, to celebrate the diversity of our community. And I think it has happened, I think.
And absolutely, and I think it's testament to, you know, the way that the month has grown and the way that people have come on board with it as well. And I think as well, also testament to the story that you guys were keen to tell, that although there is, people will have heard about things like Stonewall, there's almost the political element to sort of the recent LGBT history, but actually there is a wide and varied history within the LGBT community, which actually
absolutely,
is,
yes.
if you did just focus on one thing, you wouldn't be telling the full story.
Exactly that. And I think that's been the excitement of as we've evolved as a group of us running the month. I mean, Paul died in 2008, which was a great loss to me. And then Tony Fenwick took over, and then he died last summer. And the chair of trustees, Steve Boyce, who'd been with me way back with Paul, we'd gone to Finland together, we'd done all sorts of work together. He felt he needed to retire. So I've had to really get together a new bunch of people, along with some of the oldies, as I call them, Andrew Dobbin, who's our promotions guy, and Seth, and Nick Shenanday, who's been a brilliant person. He's been at every launch of LGBT History Month, more than I have, actually. And you can see all the photos on the website. And then, of course, we have the badges, which is how we support the month, because we're all volunteers. We don't have any core funding. All the work is done by people who are just passionate about making sure that our story gets out there.
How important is it to you that you're able to tell your story from what you've seen, almost on a front line, if you like?
I think it's crucial, and I think it's so important. And I think this summer with Black Lives Matter has been a very powerful reminder to people that we must move forward as people, making sure that we're all inclusive and that we remember everybody. And I think, you know, if you go to museums and if you go to the school curriculum, it's been a while before we have all been in there. And I think that's the massive importance of LGBT History Month and movements like Black Lives Matter, to remind institutions that they're not just serving white heterosexual middle-class people. You know, they're serving the whole population, and therefore they have to make clear who we all are and include us.
And what do you say to people who think they know the LGBT story because they've read up on Pride or they've maybe seen a march walk past them in town and they think, well, I've ticked that box. I now understand what that's all about.
Well, I am still learning. And I think if you go to the Gaze the Words bookshop in London, or if you go onto their website, it's so incredible to see just how many books now there are about LGBT people and the wealth and the difference. And one of Tony's favorite sayings was, we've been here since man began, or that, you know, as humankind began. They've always been LGBT people. And I think most people now, and for me, the importance of LGBT History Month is to show that diversity, because so often we get to hear about white gay men. And we don't get to hear about the lesbians. We don't get to hear about bisexuals. We don't get to hear about trans, although at the moment, trans people are having the most horrific a time. There's an appalling attack on them. So you're constantly hearing the bad stuff. And what we want to do is to make the celebration of LGBT people, their knowledge, their experience, and the gifts that they have brought. And my goddess, have we brought some gifts? You know, our community has been a very rich and diverse community, which has been writers, geographers, photographers, scientists, mathematicians, you name it. We've been there and we've been giving amazing gifts to everybody.
It's fascinating that, because, you know, some people say, well, you know, maybe this is a story which begins in the 1960s and into the 1970s. But actually, you hinted at it there. You can go back to ancient history and
Absolutely.
You can hear about pharaohs, kings, medieval queens who had, you know, and their stories quite clearly fits very much within the parameters of LGBT history. But for some reason, probably due to the moralizing either at the time or subsequently, those stories have kind of been shut down. But actually, there was a normalization of people being gay or lesbians throughout history. But we pigeonholed for some reason at a certain point and denied those stories being told in a more open way. But those stories are there. You can go and find them. They're quite easy to find as well, hiding in plain sight, if you like.
Exactly. Now, that's one of my favourite terms, that we've been hidden in plain sight. And one of the other things that Schools Out has done, which is the organisation under which we all work, is produce a website called The Classroom. And there we have 80 lesson plans that usualize LGBT people. And I offer that word usualize because I think normal has its problems. So we usualize LGBT people across the curriculum. So in a geography lesson, a maths lesson, a science lesson, you know, you can find little bits of information about LGBT people. So it's not an LGBT lesson, but we're in there being usualized. And I think the other reason why you hinted at it, obviously, you know, the whole moral concept, but I think we also didn't have the language. So when you go back into history, I mean, Hadrian had a homosexual relationship, the man who built the wall, you know, his lover died and he turned him into a god. So, I mean, but the words weren't necessarily there. So I think that's one of the reasons. And of course, lesbians were abounding, but again, were hidden. So, I mean, one of my favorite periods in history is the sort of 1920s in Paris, where a plethora of lesbians were having the most amazing time, both doing incredible art, writing, and were very political as well. And there's a brilliant book by Diana Suharmi called No Modernism Without Lesbians, which is just stunning and makes that point that lesbians were really there. We wouldn't have James Joyce but for Sylvia Beach, who set up the Shakespeare bookshop in Paris and had a whole coterie of people going over there. So, you know, behind Gertrude Stein, making sure that Picasso and some of those modernists were known around. So, you know, we've been there. We've been doing the most exciting things. We wouldn't have had the vote but for lesbians in the suffragette movement. But when I was at school, when we were taught about the suffragettes, then we were taught they were all white, all middle class, and all heterosexual. You know, so we're constantly being hidden. And so LGBT History Month is an attempt to say, we're here, we're queer, and we've been around for a very, very long time.
What do you say to people who think, well, great, if the LGBT community wants to celebrate their history, that's fine. How is it relevant to me? What would you say to people who maybe just don't feel or don't consider that it's something that's for them as well? What would they benefit from being part of it or just engaging with it?
Well, I think the crucial thing is that if you're living in as a human being, you're not living as a full human being if you don't recognize the diversity of the people around you. And it seems to me crucial that we have knowledge about each other and know about each other so that we can have that celebration and recognition. If you're just living in a little tunnel where you only link with people that you know and you care and you agree with or that you recognize, then you are really having a very narrow life. And the more that we know about, I mean, for me, as I began to learn more about Black writers, goddess, did it give me the most amazing enrichment and taught me so much. And I think that that's so important that, you know, we're human beings. We need to know about all our fellow human beings.
Can I get a sense from the conversation, Sue, that you've been almost inspired by other movements as well? You mentioned Black Lives Matter before, yes. But it's interesting there to hear you talk about the fact that once you hear somebody else's story on an unrelated topic, you've empathized with that story and realized, yeah, that it's actually relevant maybe to part of your story as well.
Exactly that. And I think one of the people, we have five faces for LGBT History Month this year, and one of them is Mark Ashton. And he's a beautiful example. There he was, a young gay man in London, recognizing how the Tories were attacking him as a gay man. Section 28, AIDS was happening. And then he saw the miners' strike and he saw the attack that was being put on the miners and made the link. And therefore then set up this wonderful group of lesbians and gays support the miners. They went down, they met the miners, they made links with them, they supported them. And that made a very big effect on unions, because up until then, unions hadn't really made the link that the importance of supporting LGBT people. So in fact, Schools Out was set up by a group of gay teachers back in 1974 who desperately needed support, which the unions weren't giving. So when Mark went in there and supported the miners, a big wake-up call came, and now the TUC, the Trades Union Council, and all unions are very much recognizing the importance of supporting LGBT people, making employers and employees comfortable and safe. And every year, the TUC have a big LGBT conference. This year, for the first time, it's in February, in the History Month itself. So it is amazing how, when you make links, it has enormous ramifications in making that work towards civil rights.
And we are, as part of our coverage of LGBT History Month, sort of nominating and celebrating local history makers as well. What do you think are those sort of types of stories that we'll be hearing over the course of this month? Because depending on whether you've grown up in a town or a city, you know, in a rural area or an urban area, in a place with an educated population or a working class population with a mining history, the variety is huge, isn't it? And the stories will be different.
It is massive, yes. And I think when we set up LGBT History Month to be something which everybody could get involved with. So we've got the calendar on the website and we've got a place where people can put up their events. And if you look at this year, we've already got something like 150 events, which is amazing given that we're dealing with COVID. But if you look in past years, there were hundreds of events and there were very amazingly diverse things, from people working very hard to get a pride flag being flown from their local authority or museum. Now, I know the bureaucracy involved in doing that. And that's an invisible, thankless task, but that's somebody working really hard with bureaucracy to make that happen, or get their local zebra crossing turned into a rainbow crossing. Amazing, that's really exciting. And also up and down the country, there are people who are working away, unsung heroes, doing the most amazing things. Being on the telephone as a place of safety for somebody to ring up, and so important now. I mean, with COVID, so many youngsters have been stuck at home, perhaps in a place where they don't feel safe as lesbian and gay. They haven't been able to get to their local youth group. So that phone call is so important. And there are volunteers who make sure that that's there. People running youth groups, there are so many unsung heroes that make things happen. Every year, prides. That's a phenomenal job, getting a pride together. And they, the work that goes in to make that happen is absolutely extraordinary. And there they are, busy doing it, passionate about making sure that LGBT people are visible and that they are celebrated. And to make that switch from the victimhood that we were in for so long to making into celebration and saying, yes, we are here and we are part of your community. I mean, I live here in Broadstairs stroke Margate. I'm on the corner, and Margate has a wonderful pride every year. Very small, very community, totally grassroots. But the whole, it's really changed the atmosphere of the town. And when I talk to shops, they say, "Oh yes, we really love Pride. It's great fun," and it has an effect. And I think what's been very important to me over the years, you know, we've got rid of Section 28, we've got the Equality Act. We've got some laws now which protect us, but laws are one thing. The crucial thing is culture. And I think the thing that LGBT History Month has helped to enable is that shift in culture, that shift in being able to make us more visible, that shift in enabling people to learn a bit more and be able to say, "Oh, goddess, I didn't know that. They did that. Oh, wow." And it's that process of education and culture which can shift and educate out prejudice.
I kind of get the sense from the conversation, Sue, that you're keen to sort of say that other people have been very much part of the success of the work that you've done. But in terms of yourself, Sue, what do you hope is your legacy, if you like, from the work that you've done so far and the work that you'll continue to do in the future?
Well, I hope that History Month will continue for as long as it's needed. I mean, at some point, one hopes it won't be needed, you know. But for the moment, I think we still that there is a very big right wing backlash at the moment on us. So we have to work on that. Seeing the shift in America is very exciting. Biden's gone in there and already begun to sort of undo some of the problems. It'll take some time, I think, for it to happen here because we're right in the middle of it. So I'm hoping that. What I've done over the years, hopefully, is something which will continue. But I'm always concerned that we cannot assume that because we've got to this point that it will just can't go on in a linear, successful way. There's always backdrops. There's always we're taking a back step right now. And I suppose what I hope is that people can look to some of the things I've done and be able to use that to continue the challenge that if a challenge is needed. That they've got some ideas, they've got some inspiration, they've got some ways of tackling it. And eventually, I hope that won't be needed because we'll be there, but it's going to take a while, I think.
Sue, just let people know where they can find out more about the month itself. There's a website and there's the helpful diary as well of events which people can
That's right.
Part
so
of
if you go to www.lgbtplushistorymonth.co.uk, that's the main website. And on there, you've got lots of resources that Andrew makes. There's wonderful posters. There are links to the launch that we did. So you've got little videos. Dan Vo helped us with that last year. And we've got the calendar. And the calendar, you can link on that and you can see everything that's happening in the month. Plus, you can also put your own event up. And then when you've had your event, you can then tell us all about it, send us photographs, do a little report, and we can put that up on the website as well. And of course, the exciting thing about COVID, if one can say it's exciting about COVID, but it is in the sense that it is now, you know, I'm being contacted by lots more media. And of course, all the events that we're putting up, we have 18 events for Outing the Past. We have a specific history festival, LGBT History Festival. So that's another website, www.outingthepast.com. And 18 different hubs across England, Ireland, Northern Ireland and New York have got specifically LGBT history events. And that's happened because we sent out a call and we had 70 people offering presentations for that. So not all 70 will be shown, obviously, although we've got 18 hubs, which is amazing. So we will be putting videos up on the website later. So people who are prepared to share that. So there's a lot more available. And of course, it doesn't matter where you live in the world now, you can pick this stuff up.
Absolutely. So crucial work as ever. Another important year as well. Body, mind and spirit, the theme for this year's LGBT plus History Month. And thank you for joining us today.
You're very welcome. I'm thrilled.